Hello, I'm Valerie Rose Lohman, and I'm here representing What Remains of Edith Finch. So What Remains of Edith Finch is about a 17-year-old girl named Edith. Her whole family has passed away at this point. She's the only Finch left, and her entire life she's been told that there's a Finch family curse that has all of her family members die in very odd ways. She's now 17, pregnant, and alone. And so she goes back to the house on her own, and she tries to discover what the truth is. Is there a curse? Is it just legend? Is there something wrong with her family? So that's kind of the journey, and you don't always get all your questions answered. It's very melancholy. It's very mysterious. And it also feels a little magical to me.
Why do you think this game has connected so much with so many people?
You know, I can tell you exactly why I think so, because I've had so many fans reaching out to me and telling me about this. This gets a little dark, but so many fans have reached out to me telling me how this game in particular has helped them get through dark times, helped them get through parent deaths, other family deaths, and how the experience has really helped them in their mourning process. And that has been incredibly humbling, because I have really learned how art can touch people and how art can really change lives, I guess. So to me, it's such a big gift to have been a part of it. And that's really the biggest way I've seen people have it help them, change them, how it's resonated, for sure.
You talk about the actual performance process, because I know for you, obviously, it was very brief, but quite intense, I would imagine.
Yes, I only think I recorded about 4 sessions. I had three or four 4-hour sessions, really close to when the game actually came out. I think I started recording November of 2016. I had my last session, I believe, in late February 2017, and the game came out in April. And they were intense sessions, a lot of talking with the directors and the creative team about the tone, where we are in the story, and I wanted to know a lot about each backstory of each family member, because that's such an important part, and that's not stuff that I got in the script originally, because as a voice actor you don't get the full thing. So it was an intense but wonderful process. The creative team is brilliant and so collaborative and so genuinely lovely.
How useful a tool do you think the immersiveness of games is in addressing these kinds of emotional and social issues?
I think it is so important, because I was just discussing this earlier. It forces you on another level of engagement than films and TV, and I'm a huge film and TV person. But games are on another level, because you have to sit there and you have to make choices based on each character. You have to be involved, and that really, I think, creates a sense of empathy for the audience member, because they're literally living as them. And I think that's kind of what makes it have a profound effect on people, not just for Edith Finch, for a lot of the nominated games here tonight, truly. It is a time to be alive. I'm incredibly excited, because we're having roles for both men and women that are incredibly well-rounded, incredibly exciting. And this year, to have my character be, I read an article recently about my Edith being compared to our other amazing female nominees is incredible, because we're being led by some strong, freaking strong ladies here, and I love that. It's wonderful, and it's changing the game, because, I don't know, when I was a kid, I always thought, oh, games are for boys, because my brother was really into games, and I didn't really see myself anywhere, and now I do, which is wonderful, because, I don't know, maybe some 7-year-old girl's going to play one of these and fall in love with it and want to make games herself.
I'm Ian Dallas. I was the creative director on What Remains of Edith Finch, and we won this year's BAFTA for Game of the Year, right?
Best game. And I'm Joshua Sarfati, the technical director.
The game began as an attempt to explore a feeling that I had growing up as a child, or a teenager, scuba diving in Washington State, and looking at the bottom of the ocean and the way it sloped away into an infinite darkness, and the sense of something that was at the same time beautiful but also overwhelming. And so we just tried to make a bunch of little prototypes that explored that feeling, and somehow, over the course of 4.5 years, that evolved into What Remains of Edith Finch.
one of the reasons probably why you don't see many games like What Remains of Edith Finch is because it's very difficult to make 12 different games and then keep only a very small bit of each of those games and then stick them all together. There was also an incredible amount of artwork and beautiful environments and detail that the art team put in to the house that, as a player, you consume extremely quickly and you go through it. And that was very difficult to be able to present all of that detail to the player in the time that that it takes.
The hard drive can load it.
The hard drive can load it. There you go.
Can you talk a little bit about the, I guess, the opportunity that games have to go beyond just escapism and entertainment and to actually tackle real-world social issues?
Yeah, it's been very interesting to see like the way that our game evolved into that. You know, we started from a much more kind of fantastical place of the sublime and looking at people like Neil Gaiman and H.P. Lovecraft. And yeah, I mean, I think it's to the credit of the games industry as a whole that things have evolved to the point where, you know, players are so smart and they're ready to accept different experiences. I think, you know, we talk a lot about the challenge of developing the game, but there's a huge amount of challenge on the opposite side of that, of just creating an audience that is willing to accept games like that. And even, you know, a few years ago with The Unfinished Swan, it felt like, you know, there were a lot of questions about, you know, like, oh, should this game even exist? And, oh, it's not really a game. And it's lovely to see that those problems and questions have largely evaporated and people accept that, you know, games can be all kinds of different experiences.
Hellblade was an incredible game. I mean, Gorogoa is unbelievable. Zelda. Every game here tonight is an incredible achievement made by groups of passionate and talented people, and it's a huge honor to be in that sort of company.
I mean, for us personally, it's hugely important to have another venue where, you know, games like ours can reach new audiences and people that might not necessarily even, you know about like our game's existence.